Morning. Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for attending the Journal of Law and Liberties third symposium, Plain Meaning and Context, Can Law Survive Its Own Language? NYU Law's Journal of Law and Liberty is devoted to the critical discussion of classical liberal legal scholarship. The journal publishes articles and essays addressing theories of rights and liberty, constitutional law, legislation, and the nature of rules and order from a variety of perspectives, including those of legal philosophy, law and economics, and legal history. It's my pleasure to introduce the moderator of our first panel, a generalist panel focused on the broad question of when plain meaning breaks down as a concept. Professor Burt Neuborne is the Inez Milholland Professor of Civil Liberties and founding legal director of the Brennan Center for Justice at NYU Law School. For 45 years, he has been one of the nation's foremost civil liberty lawyers, serving as the national legal director of the ACLU from 1981 to 86, special counsel to the now Legal Defense and Education Fund from 1990 to 1996, and as a member of the New York City Human Rights Commission from 1988 to 1992. He has argued numerous Supreme Court cases and has litigated literally hundreds of important constitutional cases in the state and federal courts. He challenged the constitutionality of the Vietnam War, pioneered the flag-burning cases, worked on the Pentagon Papers case, worked with Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg when she headed the ACLU Women's Rights Project, anchored the ACLU's legal program during the Reagan years, and defended the legal services program against unconstitutional attacks. He currently directs the legal program of the Brennan Center, especially its efforts to reinforce American democracy and secure campaign finance reform. The Brennan Center was established in 1994 to honor Justice William Brennan, Jr.'s monumental contribution to American law. At the same time, Professor Neuborne has forged a national reputation as a constitutional scholar and teacher. In 1990, he was the recipient of the University-wide Distinguished Teacher Award at New York University for his work in teaching civil procedure, evidence, federal courts, and constitutional law. He's an author of 3 books and over 20 law review articles on diverse areas of constitutional law and procedure. Among his best-known scholarly works is the 2-volume Political and Civil Rights in the United States, which he co-authored with NYU colleagues Norman Dorson and Sylvia Law, and the Deputy Solicitor General of the United States, Paul Bender. His 1992 lectures on American law at Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona has been translated and published in Spanish. In 2001, in recognition of his scholarship and his work in the courts, Professor Neuborne was elected to membership in the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. In 1996, Professor Neuborne appeared as Jerry Falwell's lawyer in Milos Forman's The People versus Larry Flint. In the past 14 years, Professor Neuborne has served as a principal counsel in a series of lawsuits seeking to recover property unjustly taken from Holocaust victims by Swiss banks and German corporations during the Nazi era. The litigation has succeeded in assembling more than $8.5 billion for distribution to Holocaust victims and their families throughout the world. Professor Neuborne was appointed by the court to oversee the $1.25 million Swiss bank settlement and was appointed by the United States to serve on the Board of Trustees of the German Foundation, Remembrance, Responsibility, and Future, established to distribute the $5.2 billion settlement in the German slave labor litigation. Professor Neuborne.
My goodness, Natalie, my mother couldn't have written that one better. Thank you so much. That was very sweet and entirely too generous. Before moderating what I'm sure will be a terrific panel, I have a delightful task, and that's to welcome you to NYU on behalf of the dean, Dean Rivez, who would have been here and wanted to be here, is unable to make it. For those of you who are concerned, I want to report that he's in excellent health. He's being held in protective custody while we restore democracy to the law school. But he couldn't be here because of a trustees meeting, and that was changed at the last minute. So he's asked me to express my best wishes and my welcome to all of us, to the distinguished panelists, to the students, and to the audience. And he's asked me, and I share heartily in this, to extend his congratulations to the NYU Journal on Law and Liberty, which was founded here in 2005, and in the short time that it's been on the premises, has been an engine for intellectual and a scholarly a debate that has enriched the environment. And we're grateful for it and grateful to the students who work so hard to put it together. I just ought to mention Natalie Wilson, who I ghostwrote that introduction for her, and she delivered it beautifully. And I just wanted to thank Natalie for the organizational work in putting this together, and for Nia Shah, the editor-in-chief of the journal, who's done a superb job in making the journal what it should be. The topic of the day is plain meaning and context. Can law survive its own language? Now, I love that topic because it's both plain and absolutely ambiguous. So whoever chose the topic couldn't have chosen a better symbol for what the discussion will be today. I want to get immediately to the panel so that we can hear from the experts. The only thing I want to suggest to you, and this is in the manner of homage to someone who began this discussion and began it beautifully. I first became aware of this topic, seriously aware of this topic, about 35 years ago, in response to a remarkable book that Richard Posner wrote called Law and Literature, A Misunderstood Relationship. For those of you who are looking for a way into the mystery of the relationship of language to law, and really the relationship of language to the mystery of human interaction, especially human interaction in the form of governance, Judge Posner's book is a wonderful introduction. It not only is a wonderful discussion of the relationship of language and law, but it is a wonderful discussion of how lawyers should read literature. What he has an essay there on how lawyers should read the Iliad, that is one of the great classic literary expositions about how the Iliad should be read as a parable of how revenge can never be the basis for a stable legal regime. And the book is just full of insights like that, and I commend it to you. Let me sit down now and put my other hat on, which is the moderator of the first panel. We're about to embark on what the organizers of the day have called the Generalist panel. It is a panel on exploring the relationship between language and law, and exploring the relationship between interpretation and the various agents whose job it is to interpret commands of democratic superiors in a functioning democracy. I'm going to sit down and quickly introduce the panelists and let them move forward. The format that the panelists have chosen each will spend about 10 minutes with a general exposition of their theory. At the end of the half an hour or so, I'll then pose a few questions to them, which I hope the panelists will bat back and forth among each other. Then I hope the panelists will cross-question each other a little bit about the topics, and then we'll open it up to the audience and hopefully be able to close with a few remarks from the panelists. So again, on behalf of Ricky Revez, who is alive and well and locked in a room somewhere with the trustees discussing our investments, I welcome you to the school. So now let me have do the very pleasant task of introducing the panelists. Three terrific panelists, very well qualified to speak on the topic, in alphabetical order. And this challenged my organizational abilities because so many of the letters begin with S, so I had to go at least several letters into the names, but I got it right. Scott Soames, who is the who has both the distinction and the honor of not being a lawyer. Scott is the distinguished professor of philosophy and director of the School of Philosophy at the University of Southern California. Received a PhD from MIT in 1976, taught philosophy at Yale, Princeton, and joined the Southern California faculty in 2005. He is a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and one of the nation's distinguished philosophers of language. And Scott will talk about his conception of ambiguity, vagueness, plain meaning. Lauren Solan. Larry is a lawyer, I'm sorry. He's done the best he could to overcome that by also becoming a PhD. And so he has a PhD in linguistics. His scholarship, he's a chair professor of law at Brooklyn Law School. His scholarship has been on interdisciplinary subjects related to law, language, and psychology. Especially the psychology of statutory and contractual interpretation, the thought processes and linguistic processes that go on in the act of interpretation. He wrote a superb book, The Language of Judges, which is a book that all of us use in thinking about how judges talk and interpret and make law. He's authored numerous articles, and he has a new book on statutes, the language of statutes, laws, and their introduction. He actually practiced law for a while before being rescued and allowed to come into academia. Peter Tiersma, the third panelist, is the Honorable William Matthew Byrne Professor of Law at Loyola Law School. Now, you have a great responsibility if you're the Byrne professor, because he was such a magnificent judge. Peter is the Byrne Professor at Loyola. He also has a PhD in linguistics from the University of California at San Diego, graduated from Bolt Hall and in Berkeley, clerked for Stanley Mosk on the California Supreme Court, and practiced law before entering teaching. He's a somewhat specialist in jury charges. He thinks about how judges talk to juries and how the juries are supposed to be able to follow the instructions that the judge gives them in a way that is both coherent and just. And it brings a new body of experience to our thinking. So, Scott, you want to
head off? Sure.
Sure. Okay. S-O-A. I got it right. Go ahead,
yes.
Scott.
Well, first of all, tell me, can you hear me if I speak in this tone? I'm not going to use my first 10 minutes, my opening statement, to give you my theory of language and vagueness and ambiguity, though you may coax it out of me in the discussion. Instead, I want to just set up a very general framework for talking about language and legal interpretation, and to raise some questions about it. I've learned from experience that failing to set up a proper framework for this discussion often leads to the confusion of a variety of different questions about what legal interpretation is and what it ought to be. So I just want to lay the groundwork in this opening statement. And I want to begin by making clear what I mean by legal interpretation. I mean the legally authoritative resolution of questions about what the content of the law is in its application to particular cases. In short, it's the interpretation of legal texts by legally authoritative actors. And it has two aspects, in my opinion. One is epistemological, and one is constitutive. The epistemological job is to ascertain the content of laws resulting from previous actions of other legally authoritative sources. And the constitutive job is to render an authoritative judgment that itself plays a role in determining what the content of the law is. Sometimes the judgment changes the content of the legal provisions that were the focus of the epistemological task. Now, the content of the law, as I see it, is, to a first approximation, that which the relevant lawmakers assert, stipulate, or otherwise prescribe by adopting an authoritative text. Now, just as the assertive content of an ordinary conversation can't, in general, be identified with the meanings of the sentences used in the conversation, and it also can't be identified with the conversationalist's goals in saying what they do, so the assertive or stipulative content of a legal text can't, in general, be identified with the ordinary or technical meanings of the sentences in the text, or with the policy goals of the lawmakers in adopting it. Nor can the content of the text be identified with any normative improvement of what they asserted or stipulated, or with any idealization of their speech act, such as what they would have stipulated had they known more of the relevant facts. The content of a legal text is determined, I think, in essentially the same way the contents of other texts or linguistic performances are determined, save for certain complications. For example, the fact that the agent of legislative speech is often not a single language user, but a group. The purpose of the Speech Act is usually not to contribute to the cooperative exchange of information, but to generate behavior-modifying stipulations. And the resulting stipulated contents are required to fit smoothly into a complex set of pre-existing stipulations generated by other actors at other times. Now, who are these lawmakers that I'm talking about? Well, they include those whose official actions and linguistic performances are constitutive of the contents of the law. So legislators adopting statutes, administrative bodies issuing rules, implementing them, ratifiers of constitutions, voters on ballot initiatives, judges issuing precedent-setting opinions. In private law, lawmakers include the parties of the contract, those responsible for legislation regulating the law of contracts, and judges as well as other official bodies adjudicating contractual disputes. A crucial thing to keep in mind always is that legally authoritative interpreters of the law are included among lawmakers, the actions of which are subject to further interpretation. Now, when you think of legal interpretation this simple way, I think it's just an ordinary common sense way of thinking about it, it naturally follows that interpretation is itself law governed. So there are governing legal rules that determine the responsibilities of officials who interpret texts and make other authoritative decisions about the texts. The rules may or may not be codified in statutes or expressed in written constitutions. Whether or not they're codified, they are binding social conventions concerning the duties of specified legal actors. Since the contents of these duties can vary from one legal system to the next, what constitutes correct legal interpretation needn't receive a single answer. It may vary from one legal system to another. So, we may confront the question, what is the content of the general legal rule governing interpretation and adjudication in a particular court or court system? Here's a very general, rough, and ready characterization, which I think fits a lot of systems in this country. Courts are not to legislate, but to apply the laws adopted by legislative authorities to the facts of particular cases. When the content of the law fails, as it can, to provide reliable guidance in determining a unique, acceptable legal outcome, either because it leads to inconsistent outcomes, which can happen, or because it fails to lead to any outcome at all, which can also happen, or because it leads to an outcome that is both patently absurd and unforeseen, which unfortunately can also happen, the task of the judicial authority is to discern the predominant legislative rationales of the lawmaking bodies in adopting the laws, and to fashion the minimal modification of existing legal content that removes the deficiency and allows a decision to be reached while maximizing the fulfillment of the discernible legislative rationales of the relevant laws. Now, there are various concepts in there we'll want to dig into more in the discussion, like legislative rationale. But the main thing I want to do here is simply distinguish a few questions that one can ask about this purported governing norm of interpretation. The first question, the most basic question is this or some similar rule in fact part of our legal system? Now, this is, in my view, a broadly sociological question to be discovered by empirical investigation of the accepted norms of our legal culture. I believe the rule is a reasonable approximation of the law governing legal interpretation in at least some courts of the United States, but I don't think I'm obviously right about this. The situation is muddied by the fact that the norms governing legal interpretation continue to be fought over when it comes to the Supreme Court of the United States and also the Supreme Courts of the individual states. There has been and continues to be, I think, a movement toward a more expansive and overtly legislative role for the court, not unlike the British House of Lords in the late 19th century. Whether or not I'm right that something like my more conservative governing norm is, though under challenge, still more or less in place, it's not a philosophical question. It's not a normative question. It's a straightforward empirical question. However, the second question is normative, and that is, should our legal system incorporate such a norm? That, of course, is a moral and political question. It shouldn't be worth saying, but I'm afraid it is, that for some legal systems and some candidates for governing legal norms, the answer to the empirical question may be yes, it is part of the system, even though the answer to the political and moral question is no, it shouldn't be part of the system. In point of fact, I believe the rule I've roughly outlined is a reasonably good one that not only does but should govern the practice of judicial interpretation in many U.S. courts. That's not an empirical question. That's a matter of political philosophy. Now, the third question is the one I'm really more interested in, and that's the question, what precisely does my purported legal rule require of interpreters? How much latitude does it allow them? And what factors are they to take into account in their interpretations? And here, if we were to get into this deeply, we'd have to talk about different kinds of intentions and the relationship between meaning and intention and stipulated or asserted content and a variety of other matters as well. How one resolves the application of a vague rule to concrete cases. Again, maybe in the discussion we'll get into that. What I want to make sure that we do is distinguish that question from the next one. What is the morally right thing for judges or other legal interpreters to do in particular cases? What factors is it morally right for them to take into account? That's a nakedly moral question. The previous question that I said I was more interested in is not. Answers to the previous question specify the delegated powers and responsibilities of certain legal actors. Whether or not these actors should always fulfill those responsibilities, as opposed to violating the legal rules governing them in the name of a higher good, is an independent moral question which shouldn't be prejudged. Though it may be indelicate to say so, there's nothing but intellectual confusion to be gained by denying the possibility that reaching a morally correct decision may sometimes require the members of a court of the last resort to overstep not only their actual legal authority, but their legitimate legal authority in a system in which legal norms governing their actions are politically and morally optimal. So that's a different question. Finally, I want to distinguish all those questions from the realist question. What do judges and other legal interpreters actually do? What putative legal norms, if any, do they follow in their interpretation? Now that is an empirical question too. And my interest in it is primarily in how it relates to the first empirical question, namely, whether my conservative legal norm is in fact a governing norm in our system. To the extent that judges routinely disregard a legal norm governing their actions without being rebuked, overturned, disregarded, or ignored by other legal and political actors, their behavior erodes the norm and may lead to its replacement by another norm. This is especially evident for a court of last resort, like the Supreme Court of the United States. I think there is a trend in the jurisprudence of this court in the past, say, 60 years that has put the norm of legal interpretation I have articulated under stress. For example, it is, I think, arguable that much of the jurisprudence involving constitutional issues, in particular the 14th Amendment, the Equal Protection Clause, the Due Process Clause, and other constitutional matters, such as the alleged general right of privacy emanating from penumbras of limited privacy rights mentioned in the different constitutional amendments, I think that there is a trend there that doesn't easily fit into the traditional model of impartial interpretation of laws that I sketched initially. If it doesn't fit, then it seems to me we face a dilemma. We need either to rethink some of this jurisprudence, perhaps replace some of it, or we need to rethink the traditional understanding of the relationship between democratic legislation and judicial interpretation and replace it with a governing norm that elevates the judiciary and legitimizes a more extended political role. That's it for now.
Okay. Thank you. That's I wrote down 2 hours worth of questions while you were talking. Larry?
Thank you. I'm going to focus a little bit more on the notion of plain language in the law. Scott talked about what happens when there is or is not a unique interpretation available from the language, and the law actually, in many instances, cares about the answer to that question because it may trigger the right of interpreters to do more depending on the answer to the question. I have an intentionalist view of what plain language is, that as I think language can indeed be plain, authoritative legal texts can have plain language, and the language of a text is plain when in a particular set of circumstances and with respect to a particular issue, an author who, the author of that language would mean only one thing by it, and the reader of the, call it P, and the reader of that language would understand only one thing about it, call that Q, and P equals Q. Then the language is plain. And it's important to see how so much of plain language inheres in us rather than the language itself, because language is both more and less plain than one would think if one tried to have an external view of what makes language plain. So let me give an example. If two people think that language is plain, but they understand it differently, I'm saying that is not plain language, at least not with respect to legally relevant circumstances. And that happens more than you'd think. We actually have experiments that deal with that issue. So for example, there is an issue as to what pollution means with respect to certain insurance issues. A lot of insurance policies have exclusions for pollution injury. So, and the courts are in disagreement about whether, say, if a furnace leaks carbon monoxide and the secretaries on the fourth floor become sickened, were they injured by a pollution injury? The answer to that question will tell you whether the furnace company can collect from their insurance company to recover insurance proceeds for the damages that had to be paid for making the secretaries ill. And so we asked a bunch of people this question, and lay people, and sure enough, about half said, about 40% said that's not pollution, about 40% in the street said it is pollution, and about 20% said they can't tell. We then asked them, well, how many people out of 100 that we've asked agree with you? Would you think agree with you? And I happen to know, I just told you, 40, 40, 20. Everybody thinks they're in a majority of about 60, 70%. And when we did it with judges aren't going to be tricked. They know what insurance companies say. They say everything's pollution. So only about 15 or 20% of the judges said that this is pollution, and most of the others said it isn't, with a few saying it was ambiguous. And even the 15 or 20% of the judges that said there was pollution thought they were an 80% majority. So one of the issues with plain language is language can be plain to me and language can be plain to you, but language is not plain in a legally relevant way, and the legal system has to deal with that, and sometimes it does, and sometimes it doesn't. So that's one issue that comes out of the definition. A second issue that comes out of the definition is that language need not be unambiguous for it to be plain. So for example, if I were to say, right now I'm at NYU Law School, that's true in any relevant sense that you would understand it. Namely, I'm here at NYU Law School. So if somebody were to, if there's a phone message here for me and somebody says, do you want to have lunch today? And I said, I can't, I'm at NYU Law School. They would understand what I'm saying, and I would mean only one thing by it. Namely, I'm sitting here at NYU Law School. But Professor Epstein, for example, may mean something different. He may mean I'm on the faculty at NYU Law School The question as to whether language is plain or not plain depends in part on the pragmatic inferences that one intends the hearer to make and that the hearer actually makes, even when the expression is itself subject to multiple interpretations. So ambiguous, indeterminate, and vague language can be perfectly plain for legal purposes, and that's often the case. Nobody thinks that if there's a statute that bans bank robbery, it has anything to do with picking flowers on the riverbank. Now, thirdly, lots of things go wrong when it comes to language, statutory language, contractual language, and they go wrong because language is indeterminate in ways that we don't always protect ourselves from or can't. So I've done took a lot of time, I don't mean it's important, study of cases interpreting the bribery statute. And the bribery statute, loosely, it says something like, whoever corruptly offers or gives a thing of value to a government official in exchange for an official act shall be punished. That's sort of, it's a 200-word sentence. That's sort of the gist of it. And we looked and found that there were no syntactic cases since 1971. That is, it's a 200-word sentence, and nobody gets confused about the relationships among the various actors. And for that matter, there is no semantic ambiguity that has led to legal cases. By semantic ambiguity, I mean uncertainties based on various interpretations that a structure can give you, such as, for example, if you want to, there are statutes that deal with employees engaged in interstate commerce. Do they mean those employees, the list of employees that would have been engaged at the time that the statute was enacted, these four categories, or did the legislature mean at any time that an issue arises, there's a variable and that should be interpreted? There's a semantic ambiguity, nothing like that, and the bribery statute has led to any case law. No ambiguity of reference has led to anything in the case law. Everybody knows who the parties are, what their relationships are. Language works really quite well. The problem is every single word in that statute has been litigated, a lot. So most of the problems with legal interpretation come to deal with borderline cases of word meaning. So what counts as an official act? Does the act have to be official with respect to the government for which the government worker works? Or if they tried to do something with respect to a different government, is that still an official act? Who counts as a government official? Do contractors doing government-type work count as an official? What do you have to prove corruptly? What about a thing of value? You tried to give a bribe, but you gave something that was worthless. Did you give a thing of value? All of this stuff gets litigated to the hilt, and that's true all the time, and that creates an issue with respect to plain language, but that issue has to do with language itself. That is, if you ask how well can we govern ourselves by using plain language, the answer is, in part, how plain is language? And the answer is it's not plain to that extent. And there are syntactic cases, reference cases, and so on through the literature, but they're absolutely dwarfed by issues of word meaning. And one would expect that because word meaning is a result of how we conceptualize. So, and our conceptualizations are really, and categorization is really quite flexible. And that's a good thing in life. So when you experience something new, you try to put it into a category of event or thing that you already know about so that you can create a taxonomy in your own mind about the world. And even if it's loose and ever-changing, you can understand things quickly and better that way. But the kind of flexibility that we have is sometimes inconsistent with lawmaking goals of trying to know that when new things happen, to know for sure whether it's something you can do, can't do, or have to do. Now, a second problem that, I'll get to that in a minute. I have one graphic that I want people to see. And it's notwithstanding, what do you do to get this thing going? Sorry. Great. Terrific. Thank you. Okay, we'll just leave that there and I'll sit down again. Thank you. This graphic is there are two different graphs. One of them deals with the ratio of prosecutions under the bribery statute to appeals, because I'm going to assume that there's an appeal whenever a lawyer thinks that there's enough uncertainty that the conviction was legitimate to raise an appellate issue. And you'll see that's a jagged line going down substantially. And this relates in part to Scott's talk, which is even when language is not clear, the result, especially of having common law judges making statutory decisions in which they have to not only come up with an answer, but explain their answer, and then have that answer have precedential value, does lead to some level of coherence in the law and stability in the law over time. The second, the bottom line, the solid one, deals with published appellate opinions as a result, as a function of prosecutions year by year. You have to do it as a ratio because the number of prosecutions has gone up dramatically. So it doesn't really matter how many appeals there are. It matters what the proportion of cases brought are appealed. And that went down to about 0.5% from more than 10 times that over this 35-year period, suggesting that the appellate courts don't have much more interesting to say. So the plain language of a statute, whether it's plain or not, becomes plainer as some of these uncertainties are resolved over time. So that's a fairly optimistic view of how well we can govern ourselves using plain language, putting all of this stuff together. And they're admitting that there are continuing problems, and you really need judges, and they need to make decisions, and you're not doing anybody a favor pretending that you didn't make a decision or that nobody has to make a decision. Now, what are some bigger difficulties, notwithstanding this rather optimistic view, and I'll end with that. The first has to do with legislative errors. What happens when the legislature makes a mistake? Should it be corrected? There you have plain language, in, according to my definition, and yet, you might want the rule to be that if you know that the legislature said before when they meant to say after. So there's a piece of the Class Action Fairness Act that says that you have to wait until after 7 days of an order to appeal, and then there's no deadline. You have until the rest of time. They meant that you have to appeal. You have 7 days to appeal, and most courts have corrected that error. Is that and should that be part of the rule that they correct that error? And if the rule is that you shouldn't correct the error, then does that mean that the law is immoral with respect to that? Well, most judges will correct that error and say they should correct the error as part of their decision making. If they think they shouldn't, then the question is, are they right that they shouldn't as a matter of law? And I agree with Scott that the morality of it is a different issue, unless there's enough flexibility in the role of judges to make it so that they can make the rule around the morality. And lastly, I'd just like to comment on how all of this fits into the administrative state, because that's part of the topic of this conference. And and things get much more complicated when you get to the administrative state, because I've been suggesting that the relationship between speakers, hearers, and the law has to do, the language issue comes in after you've acted, but you were going to do it anyway. So if you're going to give somebody a bribe, and you give them a bribe, and your lawyer is able to say, well, this should or should not count as a bribe for this or that reason, you knew what you were doing, and you weren't trying to gauge your activity to game the bribery statute. But in the administrative state, we see a lot more of that. That is, the relationship between the actors and the statutes are such to use the plain language of the statute as a sword with which to try to flout the intention of the law. You see this in the tax law regularly. So you read the tax code, and tax planners, Skadden Arps has great tax planning, and they tell people what it is you can do so you don't have to pay taxes that will flout the intention of the lawmakers, but yet come within the literal language of the law. The more that the law the courts then make, in a way that may or may not be too adventurous for various people's taste, different kinds of meta rules to try to make it so you can't do that, like the business purpose rule that says, well, this doesn't have any purpose, we're not going to let you do that, whatever's in the code, and so on. That kind of back and forth is a very, very serious limitation on the efficacy of plain language as the kingpin of the rule of law. And I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Peter?
Okay, I think I'm going to have to stand by the podium because I've actually came with a PowerPoint. So maybe you can where that is. Okay, I'm going to talk a bit about the rule of text. Now, you might say, what is the rule of text? Is that a typo? You mean the rule of law? Well, no, I do mean the rule of text. It's a term that I just made up. I guess if you're a speaker, you can make up terms. And so that's what I did, the rule of text. But let me try to explain to you a little bit about what I mean by that concept. And of course, by text here, I mean primarily written text. And an example of ruling by written text is Hammurabi. So the image that you see here is from the Louvre Museum in France, where the god of wisdom and law is giving this law, the code, to Hammurabi. And then in very small cuneiform writing, which you probably can't see in the bottom, we actually have the text, one of the earliest legal texts that's known. So let's start out a little bit by asking ourselves, what is the rule of text? And since I made up the term, I also have the right to define it. So here's how I define the rule of text. First of all, the notion that the legislature enacts or promulgates laws in the form of written text. That's the basic principle, which in terms of law, of course, we generally refer to as statutes. Another principle is that nothing else is law. So oral statements by legislators or by the executive are not law. And the intentions, the things that legislators have in their heads, are not law either. And then judges should simply apply these principles, the written text, to situations before them. And in particular, judges are not supposed to interpret. Now I've sort of made up a concept, I guess you could say a straw man, and now we're going to discuss, you know, whether that straw man is going to stand up or fall down. Now, it's not entirely a straw man because some people seem to more or less believe in the rule of text. And one of them is Justice Scalia, of course, and his philosophy of textualism. Now, I have here some quotes from Scalia's book, A Matter of Interpretation, and a couple of cases. For example, he says, "We live in an age of statutes. The common law is sort of gradually fading away." And he also makes quite plain that common law adjudication by judges makes him nervous. Now, he realizes we live in a system where we have common law adjudication, but he doesn't seem to like it all that terribly much if you read the first few pages of his book. And, of course, he believes that judges should not have too much interpretive discretion. So he said things like, when the text of a statute is clear, that's the end of the matter. And it is the law that governs, not the intent of the lawmaker. And then finally, judges should apply the statute as written and let Congress make the needed repairs. So that's essentially, I think, very close. It doesn't entirely overlap with my definition of the rule of text, but at least it seems to be fairly close to it. So let's ask ourselves, what is so great about written text? Why would someone want to govern by means of writing or written text? And this is something that's interested me quite a bit recently. If you happen to have any interest in it, I just published a book called Parchment Paper Pixels, where I talk about the impact of writing, printing, and the internet on the law. One advantage of written text, or writing in particular, is it's durable. It can last for a very long time. And that permits it, written text to be spread out over a wide geographical area, removed in terms of space and time from the person who wrote the text. And the durability of writing also gives it an almost unlimited power to store information. You can store vast amounts of information, far more than any person could ever remember. Now, writing, as I mentioned, can span distance and time. There's a drawback to that, and that is once a written text is transmitted over time and distance, the context fades into the background or may disappear entirely. The context that you have an oral conversation is often far less present. So writers have to express information that might be obvious in a face-to-face interaction. They might have to put those intentions into the text itself. Now, in addition, writing of this sort tends to be a one-way communication. So the author usually cannot monitor whether the recipient, the reader, is understanding that text correctly, the way that we can in oral conversation where we listen to whether someone says, and we sort of monitor whether they seem to be, we negotiate meaning, as we very often say in linguistics. Written text can also be planned, so you can choose your words with a great deal of care. You can take your time and pick just the right word, think about which term you're going to use. And in addition, writing can be quite autonomous in a sense that a writing, as opposed to speech, which is always always in the context of an oral conversation. You can't separate words from a speaker, at least not before modern technology, but writing can be relatively autonomous in a sense that it can take on a life of its own. Now, this has certain implications for interpretation. So an interpreter of written language can spend a lot of time concentrating on the exact words of the text because it's right in front of you. Oral language speech, of course, disappears as soon as I say it. That sentence is gone, right? Except to some extent that it's retained in your memory. But with a writing, you can keep looking at it and examining it. And if the reader knows that the writer has spent a lot of time encoding that particular writing, has very carefully chosen the words, then it's a very natural tendency for that reader to take those words very seriously. And finally, readers tend to take words that are relatively at face value, in other words, in a fairly acontextual or literal way. Speakers have a lot of ways of signaling that something is meant ironically or sarcastically. They can wink, they can have a certain tone of voice, but those sorts of cues disappear largely in writing. There are other ways to do it, to signal these things, but they're more difficult and they have to be part of the text itself. So that's a little bit about writing. Now, written text, it turns out, has very quickly, once cultures began to write, written text became used or started to be used for purposes of writing law. Its durability, power to transmit, and so forth, all made it a useful tool for governing larger empires. The earliest known laws, the earliest that we know of, are the laws of the king Urnammu in Mesopotamia, slightly over 4,000 years ago. Several hundred years later came the much more famous Code of Hammurabi, which we saw on the opening slide, about 1700 BC. These were written texts, of course, they were laws, but they were never meant, Hammurabi didn't really intend to govern by law as far as experts seem to say. It was more a matter of prestige. If you remember the stele that we saw at the Louvre, the picture of Hammurabi and the god Sumas was huge, and the cuneiform writing was tiny down at the bottom. It gives you an idea of the relative importance of the writing versus the political value, let's say, of putting up these images throughout the countryside. However, in ancient Greece, people did, in fact, at least in Athens, begin to use writing for something similar to what we would recognize as the rule of law. So at least at one point in Athens, when someone proposed a law, they would write it on a board. And the board would be placed in the marketplace where people could look at it, examine the text, and comment on the content of the law, which would later be adopted. Once it was adopted, it was etched into stone, and it could be referred to, and there are historical records of these stones, the inscribed law being referred to. Of course, they couldn't take them to court. It's a little difficult to carry around one of these heavy stones, but they would send someone out to the inscribed law who would write it down and take it back into court. And magistrates were required, if there was an inscribed written law, magistrates were required to follow it. So to some extent, we have a long history of written law, written text being used to limit the power of judges and magistrates. Justice Scalia didn't think it up. That notion has been around for quite a while. So tentatively, we could say that governing by written text has a lot of advantages or at least consequences. They aren't always necessarily good, but it allows the imposition of law over a large geographical area. It facilitates values of what we now call the rule of law. People can learn what the law requires, at least if they're literate, which started to happen in ancient Greece because the ancient Greeks essentially invented the alphabet. And magistrates and rulers can at some point be held to be bound by it, which of course is also an important aspect of the rule of law. Now, getting back to the subtitle of this talk, now, given that there are advantages to governing by means of written text, is it possible, as some people seem to say, to govern only by written text, without, let's say, the intervention of judges? Well, it turns out that Justice Scalia is not the first person who tried to do something of that kind. And the most prominent example is the codification efforts that took place in Europe in the 18th and 19th centuries. It was a product of the Enlightenment and of the revolutions, like the French Revolution especially. The main aim was to place all of the law in one place. And in addition, these codes, unlike previous laws, were going to be in vernacular languages, not in Latin, but in the ordinary language of the people, so that they could learn what the law was and carry it out. The discretion of judges was limited. That was another important aspect of codification, because the code contains all of the law necessary in order to govern the empire. Judges at the time came from aristocratic backgrounds very often. That was one of the political reasons they wanted to limit their power. And at least some proponents, Jeremy Bentham was the most famous proponent of codification, had the notion that if you had a code in the language of the people, that lawyers would become unnecessary. And so people would better be able to govern themselves. That's Jeremy Bentham. It's really him. Well, part of him is probably waxed by now, but you can go to University College London, and he's still sitting there, and they bring him out once a year for a special dinner. He was a rather odd guy, but he had some very interesting ideas, especially in the area of codification. So the first serious implementation of this was the Prussian Allgemeines Landrecht, which was adopted under King Frederick II, or Frederick the Great, in around 1794. Now, it aimed to cover every conceivable situation. There were over 17,000 specific articles. It was written in German so that people could read it. It was meant to educate the population in the law. Judges were expressly forbidden to interpret it, and it failed. And that, I think, is a very interesting observation. Now, why did it fail? In large part because, despite having 17,000 articles, there were situations that arose that didn't come within these articles, and the judges couldn't interpret, right? So ultimately, it was replaced by the German Bürgerliches Gesetzbuch, for those of you who know a bit about that. Now, later, someone else tried a very similar plan. And that, of course, as you can see, is Napoleon. Napoleon's the guy on the left, incidentally, if there's any question about that. Who the guy on the right is, I don't know. Rather strange-looking angel. Angels are supposed to be young and have long flowing hair, not big beards. But anyway, whoever the guy is, clearly this is Napoleon over on the left. And Napoleon's idea, it wasn't just Napoleon's idea, it was the idea of the French revolutionaries, but Napoleon largely implemented it, so it was named for him at some point, was to revolutionize and exhaustively state the entire law. Same idea as the Prussians had. All prior law was to be repealed, so it would contain all of the law that would govern France. Once again, it was meant to constrain the judges and to eliminate lawyers, or at least to make lawyers less essential. Now, the one thing that Napoleon did which was different was he stated the law in general principles rather than very specific, what we call casuistic statements. So much more general principles, somewhere around 2,000 rather than 17,000. So they're much more general, and that made the Code Napoleon a far more durable document. And in addition, what happened is, even though officially judges are not supposed to interpret, over time they began to do that, exactly that. And so now we have judges doing some interpretation, we have a more general code, and in that sense it was somewhat more successful and, of course, profoundly influential in much of Europe and the rest of the world. So those are a couple of historical efforts to implement the rule of text. Well, what about Justice Scalia, right? Is he going to be able to implement the rule of text? Will he succeed, at least if I've gotten his mission correctly? Will he succeed where others have failed? And I think there are a number of reasons, and both Scott and Larry have mentioned them, some of the problems already. There are linguistic problems. Mistake and ambiguity, I think, are relatively easy to deal with textually. In other words, once you realize there's a mistake, you can simply amend the statute. If you find an ambiguity, you can generally, it's not terribly difficult to amend the statute in such a way that we can deal with the problem. So that can, in fact, the statute can be improved so that ultimately it does more or less do what it's function fairly plainly, right, and allow for plain interpretation. But vagueness is the fact that words have indeterminate boundaries and so forth, something both Scott and Larry have written about, is a far bigger problem. And it is possible to reduce vagueness in various ways, which I'll talk about in the final paper, or I could talk about if you'd like, but it remains a problem. It's impossible to completely eliminate vagueness. And so that's a problem. Now, there also are problems, I think, with implementation. Practically speaking, if judges are not supposed to interpret, but are simply supposed to follow the plain language. Now, if you have a panel of judges and they all agree the language is plain, that's not a problem. In fact, there shouldn't even be a case in the first place, right, if the language is plain. But once judges start to disagree, now you do have a problem, and what should they do under the rule of text? Well, they shouldn't decide the issue, in my opinion, because the language is not plain, you see? So even if half the five judges think it plainly means this, A, and the four judges say it plainly means B, I don't think that they should resolve the issue under the rule of text, because if they do, they are legislating, right? Therefore, they're going to have to send it back to the legislature for resolution. That is how the rule of text, at least a pure version of the rule of text, would have to work. And the Prussians realized this. So what the Prussians did is they set up a statute commission, Gesetzkommission, and the purpose of the statute commission was to resolve ambiguities. If the judges ran across an ambiguity or other problem, they sent it to this special commission. The judges weren't supposed to interpret, and so the special commission, which had been authorized to deal with these sorts of things, would. And the French, incidentally, the court or the tribunal of cassation originally worked, was instituted for very similar reasons, to quash opinion, cases where judges interpreted the law incorrectly. So you've got implementation problems. And I think finally, if we were to do this, and you, the judges were to send hundreds of thousands of cases to Congress or state legislatures every year, I don't think that the legislature would be very interested in correcting all of those mistakes. And so ultimately, I think the rule of text is likely not to work. To a large extent, it does work. It does an amazing amount of work because so many disputes are resolved simply by looking at written text. Every time you read a sentence in a statute, basically you understand the plain meaning of that statute. But there are a number of cases where uncertainties do arise, and as I mentioned, if we were to send all of those uncertainties to the legislature, they probably don't want to do it. So the only real solution, I think, which is essentially where we are today, is an imperfect rule of text. We are ruled by text, but somewhat imperfectly, because for these sorts of practical reasons, we basically have to involve judges. And so I think this is not a novel observation on my part, but essentially I think the legislature, which has the power to interpret its own laws, has delegated that to judges. And that's essentially, I think, where we are today. So that's it.
So thank you, Peter, and thank you to all three panelists for setting up a an excellent base for you to think about it, and for us to discuss it. I can't resist commenting. No, I'm just going to just telling you the story of the French effort to do what Peter was talking about. During the revolutionary phase in about 1795. France was confronted with the fact that this is a problem of every revolution. Every revolution comes along, and you can't create new judges overnight. You're stuck with the old judges. And the problem is, how do you treat the old judges who you don't trust, who are from the ancien regime, but there's nobody else to use as to adjudicate disputes. So what they did is they passed a statute in 1795, which forbade a French judge from construing an ambiguous statute. It's the equivalent of what the German provision was. And they created a standing committee of the French National Assembly to accept references from the French judges. It was a felony for a French judge to construe a statute. And the cases poured into the National Assembly. And of course, everybody knew who would win and who would lose. And so the cases became intensely politicized, because the very reason we use judges to make these determinations as opposed to legislatures is we're trying to insulate it at least from naked political or personal animosities. And so the cases just didn't get decided. They built up, they built up, and they built up, and they built up until when Napoleon took power, and the Code Napoleon was written in 1804. If you look at Article 4 of the Code Napoleon, it is a felony for a French judge to fail to construe an ambiguous statute. It was an interesting experiment that failed, and I think Peter is right. It would fail again if we tried to do it, but not only because they wouldn't want to do it, but it's because we would be giving up the whole reason why we care so much about judicial determination, and that's the insulated, non-political nature of at least much of what judges do. And you wouldn't want to give that back and have it in the hurly-burly of a legislature. Let me just make an observation, and then we'll go on. Underlying all three wonderful presentations was the challenge of text as a command. Scott striving to make it a command as much as possible. Larry doubtful about whether the very nature of words could do it. And Peter, I think, sharing that doubt. Here's a perspective of mine, not as a philosopher, not as someone who is an expert, but who has spent a lifetime, really, in the courts, attempting to do these things as a lawyer and watching courts operate. Something coherent is going on. I mean, the idea that a judge is utterly untethered to the text, because the text is not sending some sort of coherent command, in the very large majority of cases, I think is simply not true. I don't think it empirically describes what judges do, and I don't think it empirically describes how the system works. We sometimes get trapped into thinking about these issues in the hardest possible context, in the way the Supreme Court deals with the open textured nature of the Constitution. That's the hardest argument for text. Both institutionally and in the document itself. But in the garden variety kinds of cases that make up 80 to 85% of what it is American judges do, they tend to be bound by text, and they tend to agree on what the text means relatively quickly. And just a quick empirical check. The percentage of cases appealed from the federal district courts are surprisingly low. Surprisingly low. Now, part of it is resource constraint. Part of it is a difficulty of assembling lawyers. Part of it is just people giving up. But if, in fact, it was just a free-for-all, and text wasn't playing a role, and the statute wasn't giving a command that people tend to agree on, you'd have lawyers pushing more appeals than you do. Many lawyers counsel their clients not to appeal because you go into the district court, which is basically a fact court. If you lose your facts, the governing norm tends to be a norm which is generalized and understandable. And there is a low percentage of appeals, surprisingly low percentage of appeals. There is a remarkable percentage of affirmances. Those cases that are appealed are affirmed at a very high rate in the Court of Appeals. Now, you can assume that the judges are lazy or foolish or that they simply defer to their lower court brethren. That's not been my experience. The Court of Appeals judges take their responsibilities very, very seriously, and they tend to affirm a very, very high percentage of the cases that go up. And then the last thing is that there's an astonishingly high percentage of unanimous affirmances. Now, again, part of that may be log rolling. Part of it may be the desire not to have to create waves and to create tension on the court. But again, my experience with circuit court judges is they don't have little egos. They are not afraid to say when their colleagues are wrong. And the percentage of unanimous affirmances is such that it tells me as an untutored observer, as you know, somebody who's not trained in linguistics, not trained in philosophy, that there is some form of communication going on that is either socialized, driven by text, or in some other way effective that is allowing judges to understand that there are commands and to agree what those commands are. So I want to start from backing away from the usual cynical approach to text, which says it doesn't work, it can't work, because language is too limited and law is too complex. It seems to work. It seems to work in a very substantial number of cases. Now, let me start by asking a couple of questions. Unless, do either of any of you want to react against that? Is that not consistent?
Yeah, I do want to react against that. Not against it entirely, just put a different focus on it. One thing that I find frustrating about discussions of this kind, when text and textualism tends to be the focus, is that it's not recognized explicitly what we all know implicitly, namely that the words we use are very effective vehicles for the messages we convey, but they are not the messages we convey. We are very good at figuring out what somebody is asserting, what they're stipulating, what they're telling us to do. And the words used by the person, probably the most important thing, but they're not the only thing. There are a variety of background constraints and information that we all share. If you had asked me, maybe you did at the beginning, are you ready? And if I may have said, I'm ready. Well, that's a complete sentence. It has a plain meaning. But the plain meaning is a rule which tells interpreters how to figure out what the person said. And part of the rule is there better be something contextually relevant, expected, that everybody recognizes, some task for which the person who says he's ready is ready. That's in the air, that's in the background, that's in the context, that's in our heads, that's in our intention. It's not in the text. When somebody uses, for example, a compound noun, possessives are a good case. John's car. Is it the car he owns, the car he drives, the car he rented, the car he built, the car he's dreaming about buying? Well, the language doesn't tell you, and it's not ambiguous with 100 different meanings. It's incomplete. And we all know that it's incomplete, and we all know on a given occasion, or except for very odd situations, what's being talked about. And Larry had an example of a compound nominal, official act. Well, that can be a variety of different things. Just like if you talk about a given kind of, let's say, pill, a diet pill or a pain pill or a headache pill or a sleeping pill, what's the relation between these things? Well, they're different. And the language doesn't impose this. We figure it out from the context. The text is the beginning. The text gets you to the message. If we really were to have a discussion about the role of judges, yes, they should have some idea about how to get from the words to the message, okay? And that's an epistemological part of interpretation. And it involves reading certain kinds, but not every kind, of intention of the speakers or of the legislature. But then there's the next question. Even when you've got that, even when the command is clear, its application in a given case may not be clear. And that's not necessarily a matter of language.
I do want to add, I agree with just about all of that, except that I think that the legal system has underestimated the difference between spoken and written language. And what Scott says, I think, is very true of spoken language. You communicate a huge amount of information simply through shared background assumptions and nonverbal communication and tone of voice. But in a writing, at least the sorts of writings that we do in law, much more of our intentions has to be explicitly placed in the text in words. And so one of the examples that I've used for this is, suppose you're stranded on a desert island, you were sailing out of Hawaii, and your boat went down, and you're on this island, and a helicopter flies by, and you can just yell, help, help, and wave your arms, and the message, I think, is pretty clear, right? I'm on this island, please come get me. But suppose that instead of that, all you have is some empty bottles that you found washing ashore, and you happen to have some paper and a pencil, and you're going to put a message in the bottle. Can you just write help and put it in the bottle and expect that you'll ever be rescued? The answer is no. What you're going to have to do is put far more of your communicative intentions into that text. You're going to have to say, I'm stranded on an island. I left Lahaina on this or that date. 2 days later, sailing in a direction towards Tahiti at this speed, so many knots, my boat went down, and then plug it. And if you put enough of those messages out there, there might at least be some chance that people would be able to extrapolate where you are. You see, all of that information is obvious in a face-to-face context, has to be made explicit in a written text. And that's one reason that laws and statutes are so different from ordinary language. Yeah,
but it occurs in writing as well. And Scalia in particular gets confused about this, though his heart is in the right place. In the Smith case about the use of a firearm. And he makes a series of brilliant observations about what would be questioned or asserted if somebody asked, have you ever used a firearm? And the guy says, no, he's not going to be indicted for perjury if he has a musket on his wall as an ornament. But he makes the claim about meaning. And then the court majority, points out correctly that his claim about meaning is wrong. This case was wrongly decided, I think, because the court and the dissenter both confused the plain meaning of the statute with that which was asserted or stipulated by it. And that was written.
Larry?
Yeah, I want to, I think I agree largely with Scott, a lot of things that are in our heads, but I also experience the law the way Burt does. That is, you might say, I don't like what the governor of Wisconsin's doing, I'm moving to Canada, but I don't know too many people who want to say, I don't like statutory interpretation in this country, I'm moving to Canada. It largely works okay, and I experience it as such. Now, why? The problems arise, so there must be enough shared understanding of circumstances and shared assumptions so that we don't have serious breakdowns all the time. And that could be because we put enough information in the text or just because we share the assumptions. That's number one. Number two, most of the problems, as I mentioned earlier, with statutory interpretation involve issues of word meaning and borderline cases, boundary issues with respect to concepts. The way it works is that we have people, part of the way we conceptualize involves knowing what the paradigmatic cases are of something. In the famous studies from the 70s, somebody says, I'm going to give you a category, furniture, and on a 1 to 7 scale, tell me how well these various things fit into the category of furniture. 1 is, this is a great example of furniture. 4 is, I don't know. And 7 is, that's certainly not furniture, so this is a 7, this pen, and a chair is a 1. But what happens when you use words like clock or piano and various things? It's not just that everybody agrees that it's a 4. What happens is you get people fighting over whether it's a 3 or a 5 or a 2 or a 6. And so consensus dissipates when we talk about unusual things. But most of the cases are about usual things because the legislature got it right. So when the legislature passes some kind of a tariff on the importation of furniture, most of the time you know perfectly well what furniture is and what's not furniture, and you do have the fights on the boundaries, and there are intentional issues, or they just didn't think about it enough. But between language working pretty well, shared assumptions about circumstances and the kinds of context that you need, and the legislatures having more or less the right prototypes in mind when they pass laws works pretty well. So how many I've written about these use of firearm cases as well, and how many cases before you get to somebody, Mr. Smith wanting to trade a machine gun for cocaine, which is what that case was actually attempt, 30-year obligatory sentence for using a machine gun in a drug trafficking crime when he drove off with an unloaded machine gun in a box. How many cases are there where people really are using a, you know, they come and they hold somebody up in a drug crime? So the legislature, there could be thousands of cases where the law's working within the paradigmatic situation. The appeals lawyers are not busy because that's what their client got caught with. And if they want to argue mistaken identity, well, they can, but they probably, you know, if they lost, they're not going to have an appeal on that. And nobody's worried about any of this stuff. So the issue isn't whether the problems arise, they do. The issue is how much the legal system can chug along with those problem without those problems crippling a notion that we're living under a rule of law.
Mm-hmm. How should you decide the Smith case?
Why don't you give the facts of the Smith case?
Yeah. I'm just curious as to which way. I agree with you.
The statute said use or carry.
That's right.
So there's a use case, which is Smith, and there's a carry case, which is called Muscarello. The Smith case, the use case, is really pretty. There's one remark in it. You know, Justice O'Connor writes the majority opinion. She looks up the word use in 11 dictionaries, and it says utilize. So you see, and Scalia says, well, using, when you think about it, you're thinking about the prototype. Using it as a firearm. So the real debate in that case, in my opinion, is whether you should be looking at prototypical language, which is what Scalia says is the norm. It's the ordinary language rule, which will constrain judges, or you should try to look at the outermost boundaries of words, the definitional approach, which says if it can count at all, it's going to count for the law, which is what the majority did.
Like a bad crossword
puzzle. Exactly. So I, you know, in terms of the spirit of interpreting criminal statutes, I would have interpreted it narrowly, but like Scalia, yes.
Yeah, I mean,
what was the carry case?
Same thing. They had, there was a gun in the trunk of the car and the drugs in the glove compartment, and they indicted this guy for carrying a firearm. And the question was, that counts as carrying.
That's an extra penalty.
Extra. So they look it up in a lot of dictionaries, and then the majority says, well, you know, the Bible says he carried the corpse on a donkey, so you can carry things in a vehicle. And then the dissent says, no, they you know, he carried something in his hand, so see, so it was very, very silly. They should have just let lenity take over, and, you know, we don't know what this means, and. Either yeah. Clarify it or just give him the 6 years he would have gotten anyway.
Sometimes they get it right. When they had you're facilitating using the telephone to buy drugs, you're facilitating a felony because you let somebody use your phone or something like that. which would have meant a misdemeanor to a very serious felony, they invoked lenity. And they said the lower court had read facilitates literally. And they said, no, he facilitated 30 years. This was Souter's last opinion, Souter's last textual opinion. And he got it right. I mean, they said can't possibly mean it. Let me ask one last question, and then we're going to go to the audience, okay? And this is a sort of antecedent political judgment problem that I, because it seems to me that there's both an empirical question and, as you guys point out, a moral and a political question about how one approaches text. What do you think the best metaphor is for describing the relationship between a judge and a democratic, a hierarchically superior democratic commander? We often use principal agent, or a faithful agent. And my question to you, especially to you, Larry, because of the way you talked about the bribery statutes, is it a better way to talk about them as senior and junior partners engaged in an enterprise that will eventually result in a coherent legal set of rules? I mean, how should we think about that kind of relationship? If that's useful.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I've never been a big fan of having one phrase capture the entire relationship. But But generally, I mean, I think the hard, let me talk about what the hard case is that makes it hard to answer this question. It really has to do with the legislative mistakes. And there are two kinds of legislative mistakes. One of them that Scott says is out of bounds, and most judges would agree with him. So that's the LSD case, for example. There's a case, Congress knows how to abuse various substances, so they know how to write laws about it, but they don't know much about LSD. So they wrote a statute that made it so that if you have, it said something like minimum penalties for a substance or mixture containing more than a minimum amount of various drugs. And they were really thinking about heroin, and they didn't want to give you credit for the fact that heroin's cut about 1-to-1 right now. So whether it's cut or it's not cut, you're going down for the weight of the heroin. But LSD, you can take a drop of it and diffuse it over blotter paper, and then put a piece of that blotter paper in a glass of orange juice. And if the glass of orange juice is big enough, it could weigh a 0.5 pound. You can go to jail for, you know, God knows how long you can go to jail, depending on how thirsty you are. So that's the issue. And the question is, you know, how far are you going to go? Most judges, although Posner dissented in the case, were saying, listen, if the legislature made a mistake because they didn't know enough and wrote a stupid law, we really feel bad for this guy, but there's nothing much we're going to do about it. Some judges will go further then and say, you know, we're all teammates here, and we're going to help out. That is so irrational that either we're going to say it violated substantive due process and throw it out, or we're just in a nice way going to help you out. That's really where the limiting cases are. Mm-hmm. Almost all judges will take Scrivener's errors and correct them, with a couple of exceptions. There's Judge Bybee just wrote a very aggressive pro-textual opinion about this class action fairness act. Very outlying, though. So now, if you're depending on where you draw those lines, you have to decide what it means to be a faithful agent.
Exactly.
And so I these characterizations I find very difficult, because you end up arguing about the borderlines of the characterizations and have the wrong discussion. Mm-hmm. But there's where the line is. Most of the rest of the time, I think most judges are saying, you know, what's the legislature getting at? Is there at least a hook in the language so I don't have to feel too much out on a limb that will allow me to do what I think is going on with the language? There almost always is. There are no judges that don't care about language, no matter what people accuse them of. I don't know of a single one. It's not even easy to find cases where the language played no role in it. Anywhere. I mean, people, I don't even agree that Holy Trinity Church did that, but even if you do, it's 120 years old. Can't you find something in the last century? You can't find one case in the last century and you're having a nervous breakdown over judges not caring about language. They do care about it, and those are where the lines are.
Shall we open it up to the audience for a while? Let's see. If you'll direct your question to someone to the panel, that's great. Or if you can't, want to direct it to me, and I'll kick it over to somebody.
Thank you. I guess my question is more for Professors Solan and Tiersma. You both raised the issue on the issue. Plain meaning has to be something that, you know, not just one person says it's plain to me, it's more than one person. But that seems to me to assume or presume that people have no agenda, that they're being completely honest and rational and reasonable. It seems to me, if you look historically at the first few decades of the 20th century, there was a big shift among certain people who, and previous to that point, who wanted to achieve certain policy goals, wanted to achieve them by amending the Constitution, but then they realized that through advocacy lawyering and advocacy judging, or if you want to call it judicial supremacy, they realized, why would we want to amend the Constitution through the legitimate constitutional process? We could just continue having cases and then overturn what even they realized was the plain meaning of the Constitution, and then have cases overturned simply because they had allies on the bench, allies elsewhere, and through repeated set up cases, they could just alter, you know, as my con law professor always said, she thought judicial acrobatics is a good thing. So, and my other very quick question for Professor Tiersma on the Prussian and the French constitution, or I'm sorry, the law codes, which had 17,000 statutes. Do you think there's a different way of interpreting, let's say, the U.S. Constitution, which is very different from that, U.S. constitutional interpretation versus common law statutory, common law interpretation and statutory interpretation, where the whole paradigm of the way the law is set up is very different. Thank you.
Yeah, I think part of what you're saying, at least the way that I understand it, is that ultimately if you admit that the rule of text, as I've called it, is not really possible and you have to have some interpretive discretion in judges, that of course means that you have to have a lot of confidence in your judges, right? And so you've got to have a system where judges are, of course, that's a very politicized decision in the United States, but you'd want to have some sort of system that guarantees that that people do have confidence in the judges. And I suppose in our system, the fact that they have lifetime tenure and they're picked, over a number of years, or you have differing governments in power, in theory should guarantee that your judges represent a fairly broad section of the population. But yes, choosing your judges, I think having confidence in them is very important. Now, the other point you raised about the difference between interpreting a document like a constitution and statutes, for example, I think is also very important, and it's something that people also don't, in my opinion at least, think enough about, and that is that there is, you don't interpret everything exactly the same way. A grocery note, you might interpret very differently from a will that someone has written very carefully. And you simply, the reader or the interpreter has to have a theory of the text that the person is interpreting, how it was made, under what circumstances it was made, whether it was very carefully drafted or just sort of jotted off, without a lot of thought. And in that sense, when we look at a constitution, then I think we inevitably are going to interpret it differently from a statute. I would say that statutes would be interpreted in a far more textual way, in the way that the Prussian Landrecht was. Whereas if you have the Constitution? A Constitution would be interpreted more like the Napoleonic Code, something that has broader principles without looking, trying to take it apart. One reason that the Articles of Confederation probably failed is they were too specific, right? And so this broadness is helpful in having something endure, but it also means that you're necessarily going to have somewhat more interpretive discretion in order to keep it up to date, whereas a document like a statute can be amended much more easily, and as a result, you're more likely to take the words, the exact meanings, the plain meanings of the words somewhat more seriously. At least that's my approach. I don't know if Larry wants to add to that.
Well, it's interesting because Justice Scalia, who's such an articulate purveyor of textualism and statutory interpretation, is also quite a contextualist when it comes to the Constitution, where he has this historical originalist approach. You can argue about his history, but he certainly thinks you should use history. He thinks you shouldn't use being very much about the statute. So they're really the Constitution and statutes. It's a separate question as to whether you should have the same relationship between the judge's concern about language with each. It's a political question, as you were saying. It's not the same. It's not just automatically a matter of language. And they take very different attitudes towards it in ways that it's just beyond where I want to talk right now. But you raised another question, which is, are you really saying that anytime two people say that something means something different, then you don't have any plain language? Because every time there's a litigant, like anytime somebody got on the wrong end of a deal, his lawyer's going to say, well, we better say that this meant this. And the fact that he said it, one might think, shouldn't trigger the legal system agreeing that there's no plainness to the language, or you're going to cripple the legal system, and you're going to provoke dishonesty. That's why you have the parole evidence rule, for example. So I understand that that's an issue, and even a soft parole evidence rule does some good that way, where you can make some investigation as to whether somebody reasonably really is believing this, or they're just taking litigation positions, but back then when they when they signed the contract they didn't. But that's a genuine problem that you raised.
Can I raise a question for people who do constitutional interpretation?
Scott, into the mic.
I just don't know how you think about this. Plain language. Okay. Now let me read this. Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech or of the press. Okay? That's plain. I don't think I have a hard time understanding what it means. It sounds like what it means, no law whatsoever
Congress,
having to do with Congress. Speech or, yes, Congress.
Congress, so the president can do what he wants.
Okay, but
well, I mean,
even
you can't,
Congress.
You can't take the First Amendment and claim that it is plain when the very first word in the First Amendment is something we totally ignore. We don't want the First Amendment just to regulate Congress. We want it to regulate the entire government. So if it said the government shall make no law, that's the first one. The second one is the freedom of speech. It doesn't say Congress shall make no law abridging speech. It says Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. The freedom of speech is a concept that has to be fulfilled. That's why threats are not protected. That's why blackmail isn't protected. That's why the mere fact that you're using...
Is all of that in the meaning of the sentence?
Well, if you have to take the sentence and give it meaning in the real world, then you have to think about it.
Okay, now, yeah, give it meaning. What was commanded? What was asserted? What was stipulated there? It's not just the plain meaning. It's got something to do with the world, as you say.
Well, all right. Richard, I found over the years it's impossible to keep him out, so I always invite him in. So go ahead.
No, I'm
teasing you. Go ahead.
Look, there is a long... One of the interesting things about it is the kinds of questions you're raising about freedom of speech were raised in every ancient legal system long before. And there's a long, what they call interpretive tradition, trying to figure out how it is when you take a particular naked text, you then put it into some larger understanding. So you take the biblical text, thou shalt not kill, and the question, does that mean that self-defense is illegal? And all of a sudden everybody says, well, we really don't mean anything about that. And it turns out that what you called social context in the individual cases, you know, I understand what you're saying when we get ready, there is a kind of a universal social context around which all of these terms are put, and then the question is, can you develop that? And I think the answer is you can, but you can only do it in terms of a kind of a political theory of one form or another. And if you start going down the First Amendment and all the exceptions, it's not that just, you know, it's not just Burt Neuborne hyperventilating, which is perfectly appropriate, is they actually organize themselves into several categories. There's the category having to do with threats of force, there's a category having to do with lies, there's a category having to do with monopolies, there's a category having to do with essentially incompetence and so forth. All of these categories were perfectly well understood in the Roman text. In fact, I once wrote a paper in which I said it's an absolute one-to-one correspondence between the way in which the Romans read the Lex Aquila and the way in which we read the provisions on unreasonable searches and seizures. And so what Burt is doing is bringing the tradition, I think, into this kind of thing. And since you're a philosopher, right? And so, I mean, you know, this is not your tradition, it's our tradition. And so
well,
what happened...
But there's a lexical issue there, too, because the word freedom has to be dealt with.
Well, I understand. That's the whole... The way we deal with freedom, in effect, is to say speech is presumptively free except when, is the way in which we think. Lawyers think in terms of presumptions. And it's an extremely important part of our vocabulary and our technique. But the word freedom is a signal that we do that. Unlawful is another such word, which is the opposite side. Same kind of signal. So there's some words that have discrete content. You know what it is to lie, but you don't know what it is to be unlawful. One of them requires a description and the other requires a normative theory. I think it's the way in which I would put it.
Let me see if you accept this paraphrase in Larry's term. Larry said, plain meaning... We have plain meaning when the relevant people agree that they mean the same thing. The guy says the sentence, he has in mind P. Somebody hears the sentence, she has in mind P. So are you saying that because of this ancient legal tradition, when the First Amendment was adopted, the framers and ratifiers all had in mind P, which is what we have in mind today?
Well, P is a proposition, the answer is no. P is a tradition, the answer is yes. that is, one of the things about this, which is, I think, not widely understood, is that the interpretive traditions that developed, starting with Rome, going through canon law, coming into the English common law, are much more closely allied one to another, with much lower variances than one would expect. And so that if you went back to this kind of tradition, even though you didn't know which particular part of it you were looking to, I think you'd find 80, 90% correlations. And it's interesting, all the doubtful cases that come up under First Amendment law, where the tradition has pretty much been respected, are cases on the fringes, unless, and here's the caveat, you get a different tradition. So the speeches, for example, on campaign finance come out of a completely different situation, and they signal that. The great progressive, an NYU guy, thoroughly unsound, Elihu Root, said this is what we ought to think about money in politics, and all of a sudden the old tradition is gone and the progressive tradition is in place, which is what happened in the McConnell case, right? I mean, you could see the signals, but within the classical legal traditions, yeah, I think the tradition was extremely tight and very well honed.
Thanks. I had two fairly general questions that I wanted to raise about the conversation so far. One concerns the discussion of intent as opposed to the text itself. And there's been a fair amount of discussion of the idea that that's where we should actually be looking for at least some portion of the meaning. And I was wondering if you guys could comment on whether, in fact, you think that there is a coherent notion of intent that you can find from a collective body such as a legislature. I was also wondering if you could comment, the conversation so far has been focusing on the interpretive decisions largely by judges, and I was wondering whether you think that similar approaches would be appropriate to interpretive decisions made by individual citizens in trying to determine what the law is in their ordinary lives. To the extent that that we're considering the particular relationship of judges to legislatures, it seems as though that would leave open either different standards for interpretation by individual citizens or sort of an awkward situation in which individual citizens would have to be deciding what it was that judges would do as opposed to interpreting the law directly. Thanks.
Okay. Can I just amend? I'm going to amend it a little bit, just not much, but just because I think you put your finger on such an important topic that I want to. There are at least five possible hearers. There's the individual who's trying to decide what to do with his life. There's the cop who's trying to decide whether to make an arrest or not, and whether to let you do 70 on the Long Island Expressway when the text says 55. There's the FTC commissioner who's trying to decide what the regulation should look like dealing with there's a lower court judge trying to fit this into a coherent model of past cases, and then there's a Supreme Court justice with at least the possibility of changing course. And is there a single interpretive philosophy that should be followed by people of that varying type of
responsibility? I think various of those actors are doing different things. And one thing that is involved is, what did the legislature say? Then there's a question of, how does it fit this particular case? Is this a case that is, let's say if it's a cop, is it worth picking up this person as opposed to this other person? I can only do a certain number of things. That's a kind of decision about the effect of the law in particular cases that doesn't really have anything to do with a dispute about the content of the law. What the cop has to decide, he may be confused about the content, but he may not be. He may be perfectly clear about it, but there's still something further decision that he has to make about what to do in particular cases, given that he has finite resources. And judges, too. Not everything a judge does is determining the pre-existing content. The judge can make further decisions about what to do in a particular case that may or may not change that content. So there's more than one kind of action that is called for on the part of different actors, even if they agree on the content.
Two things. First, in terms of legislative intent, I actually think that that can be coherent in a lot of circumstances. If the legislature decides in advance that a small group of people are going to be the only ones who understand some amendment to the Internal Revenue Act or various of the environmental laws, and there's agreement in advance that they're going to work out the details and they're going to be the only ones who know them. In fact, they're the only ones who can pronounce the words when it comes to, you know, chemicals and so on. Then there is nothing less democratic about referring to the intent of the legislature as the intent of that group than there was in delegating it to the group in the first place. And Article 1, Section 5 of the Constitution allows Congress to make the houses to make their own rules. And one of the first rules was that we're going to have committees doing this because you can't function any other way. So there are plenty of coherent group intent situations, although not all of them are, because sometimes there wasn't appropriate delegation and so on. Burt, really, I love his amendment to the question and the question itself. There's the rule of lenity, which says that criminal statutes are to be interpreted narrowly, but you can simulate a lenity situation just by not arresting people who didn't commit prototypical crimes. So there's a lot of statutory interpretation that goes on with the police. I once wrote a paper called Statutory Inflation and Institutional Choice. When you have both an agency bringing civil cases and a Bureau of the Justice Department prosecuting, you wind up with a great amount of broad interpretation with no new legislation, because the civil cases come from the SEC or from the Environmental Protection Agency. Some judge is going to buy into it. And then there's going to be some statute that says whoever willfully violates this statute or the regulations promulgated hereunder. And once those violations have moved as a result of the civil litigation, the criminal law expands also. So it's a very complicated question. People are playing different roles, and how you set up those roles are going to have substantive effects on how the laws are going to be interpreted in the long run.
I think this is an interesting question, too, and I end up spending far too much time trying to figure out how to explain complex legal concepts to ordinary citizens, because I'm the only person who is both on the civil and criminal jury instruction committee, because they couldn't find any other idiot who would do both of those things. But anyway, so I spent a lot of time thinking about exactly these sorts of things. And of course, the fact is that we do have sort of interpretive conventions, textual practices, which develop, as Richard Epstein said, within, you know, the legal community. At least I think that's part of the point, where people have a way of interpreting things and where a lot of things don't have to be said because the people who are speaking to each other essentially have common shared background information, understanding of the legal system and legal terminology and so forth. But of course, that doesn't count when ordinary citizens are involved, because they don't share. They're not part of this interpretive community. And so that's why I've always said, I'm a great proponent of textualism in certain situations. I'm a proponent of textualism when you need to have a very clear text, a transparent text that doesn't require you to read a lot of judicial opinions and have this background information. So in my opinion, when we're talking about the criminal law decisions ought to be very textual, so that you create a criminal law which is relatively transparent. But when you're talking about the sort of thing that Larry is talking about, then intention is really all that matters if you're communicating, if there's a communication from Congress to a small group of bureaucrats who understand essentially what some of the cryptic language that Congress is using. And in that case, you don't need to be nearly as much of a textualist. Now, it's interesting, Jeremy Bentham also thought about this issue, because he realized that the codes that he was such a proponent of might be rather technical at times and difficult for ordinary people to understand. So at least at some point, he suggested having two sets of codes. One would be the ones that was sort of like the official version that was used by the government and the judges and was very complicated, and the other would be a more plain language one that was easier for people to understand so that ordinary citizens could put it up in the bookshelf next to the Bible, where the, you know, the two books that most people would be likely to have in those days would be easily accessible to help them guide their conduct. So.
Over here and then over there.
I think this is essentially a question for Scott, but don't you get the impression there are two quite distinct notions of plain meaning floating around in this discussion right now? One that really concerns what we would call narrowly as philosophers of language, the text itself and the meaning you can actually get from the words and the syntactic arrangement and so on. And something else it might not be better to call plain understanding, which can be cashed out in the way Larry was talking about, convergence, by the people to whom this type of text was directed, that is, judges, lawyers, and so on, where that notion of convergence that you're going to get gives the idea that there is something that we can call plain meaning merely this, that there is convergence amongst those people. They're not going to get into a certain type of dispute, which is very different from the notion that I think you're getting at, which really concerns what you've got that underdetermines the legal content, the actual statutory content, where you're talking about what the individual meaning, dictionary meanings of the words, the syntactic structure, the way this is put together, what that gives you is something very, very thin indeed that radically underdetermines anything you'd want to call the plain understanding of what you would get from using that very sentence in that very part of the statute. So it's in the Smith case, for example, where the ultimate question in this is, do you think there's any value into trying to sell the distinction that you and I both take very seriously between the sentence meaning and the propositional content of the sentence as it occurs in some particular environment, into getting people to see that it's not a question of linguistic meaning itself that's at issue, it's rather a question about the sorts of very rational inferences one's going to go through in order to get a sensible understanding. So with the Smith case in particular, O'Connor says it's not the job of Congress to start inserting new words into the law. The phrase as a weapon doesn't occur anywhere in the statute. We can't start inserting it. But we know that's not the only way to get that understanding of that. And whereas on the other side, Scalia is saying, well, look, it's to do with the normal, ordinary, plain use of the word use. Well, we know that's not the right way to tackle the problem either. But given the massive convergence that there is in all these cases that Burt was talking about at the beginning, this is so rare that we really get into these issues. Is it worth our while, as philosophers of language, forcing this distinction down the throats of lawyers and judges just so that they make the decisions for the reasons we think they should make them rather than the reasons that they think they should make them?
Well, yes, it is important. The way you think about it is the same as the way I think about it. What Larry's talking about when he talks about plain meaning is what I'm talking about when I talk about, well, what's the assertive content? What was stipulated? What was said? What's the message that was conveyed? And in the standard case, in the overwhelming majority of cases, there will be this kind of convergence that you talk about. And that's the real text, so to speak. The text is not, that's the real content of the law. That's the thing to be faithful to when you can be faithful to it. Now, you can't always be faithful to it for a variety of reasons, but and that's where there's a degree of legislation that sometimes has to occur on the part of interpreters. But that first level that we're aiming at is not the written word. It's that which is conveyed by the written word, reasonable inferences that are converged on by the right class of people. Yes?
I really interesting, because it seems to me that if you take the words at their plain meaning, you could probably, you know, say that they could be interpreted just simply that way. And kind of what I was hearing is, in that example of something that says, you know, the commandment that says, thou shalt not kill, that we don't think that that's what it means because it's not consistent with our shared understanding and notions of fairness and everything else suggest that there should be exceptions to that, such as, you know, except in self-defense. But I guess I sort of have two questions. you could just take it, at it, first of all, you could just take both of those things just at their plain value, right? And you could say, well, you know, what is written is written, and you could interpret it as such. And there was an opportunity, since it was a written document, to give more specificity, maybe not so specific that it would be completely restrictive, but specific enough so that it's not completely broad. There would still be ambiguity, even if you said, thou shalt not kill except in self-defense, there would be some ambiguity. Well, what's self-defense? You know, what's killing? Who? You would never be 100% specific, but you could give more specificity, and there was an opportunity, and that opportunity wasn't taken. So why do we need to assume that? Why do we need to assume this additional context, I guess, on top of it? Because it seems like we could just read the words for what they stand, just like the word furniture. Most people agree what it is, we know what it is, we could just read it very strictly.
In most cases, we do converge, and I think that's what you're saying. There is a plain content that we gather. However, even though we may want to adhere in general to the plain content of thou shalt not kill, or the plain content of Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech, and even though we may have some of the same exceptions in mind, it's very unlikely that we've thought of all of the exceptions. It's very unlikely that there will be one tradition which has categorized all of the exceptions. You may have to, at certain point, choose among traditions. And this is a kind of legislative role that certain judges and justices can, I think, legitimately play.
But I guess what makes us assume that there should be exceptions, if it says no law, isn't that fairly clear?
It is, I think, quite clear. but I think it was also quite clear that even at the time it was ratified, it was not no law whatsoever of any kind. I think that that's at work in broad constitutional principles, and there's an expectation that there's a further refinement to be made, because no one thinks that they can foresee all the relevant circumstances that will arise.
I think it's 11 o'clock, let me thank the panelists very much for what was a terrific, terrific discussion, and especially for finishing on time. So,